Hello, my favorite science squad. I have a question to you. Why do people have different eye or hair colors, and why do we different size? Well, the obvious answer is that each of us contains a unique set of DNA sequences. But even identical twins who share their DNA sequences can start to look quite different as they age. And why do cells in our bodies look so different from each other? They all share the same DNA. So what happens here? My name is Gavin Steinek, and today we'll talk about gene regulation, epigenetics, and how we try to develop new treatments against epigenetic diseases. I wanted to do this video for a while now, since my colleagues and I work in these fields of research. I put a lot of effort and love into this video, so sit down, relax, and let's dive into the magical world of epigenetics. Our story today begins in the 1950s. For quite a long time, scientists knew that we inherit traits from our parents, but they did not know how that happens. This all changed when DNA was identified as the source of inheritable genetic information. A little bit later, the main purpose of DNA was uncovered in the central dogma of molecular biology. In principle, DNA, or more precisely genes, can become active and be used to make RNA, which is then often converted into proteins. We now know some additions to this rule, but the important thing is that genes can be used to make RNA or proteins, which then have different effects on the cell. So this is how DNA works in a nutshell, but there is something weird. Most of the cells in our body share the same genetic information, meaning they have the same DNA, but they can look and behave very differently from each other. A muscle cell does not look like a neuron or a skin cell. So these cells have the same DNA, and yet they are so dissimilar. And the main reason for that is that cells normally only activate a certain set of genes. So the main difference between all the different cell types in our bodies is only which genes are active. Turning genes on or off is achieved by a process called gene regulation, and gene regulation, on the other hand, depends on epigenetic changes. Epigenetics is a scientific discipline where we study mechanisms in a cell which activate or inactivate genes. So I guess we shouldn't say epigenetics, but instead epigenetics. We already covered epigenetics a bit when we talked about ancient viruses which want to mess with our DNA, but epigenetic changes are important to also make all the different kinds of cells in our bodies. There are quite a few different epigenetic mechanisms which regulate gene expression, but we will cover DNA methylation and histone modifications. The first layer of epigenetics is DNA methylation. In most high school textbooks, we learn that DNA contains four different units called adenine, thymine, cytosine, or guanine. What is often not emphasized is that one of the four units, cytosine, can be modified to regulate genes. During DNA methylation, cytosine is converted into 5-methylcytosine. And if we find high amounts of 5-methylcytosine next to a gene, then a gene is often inactive. In other words, no RNAs or proteins can be made, and this is one of the ways for which cells regulate gene expression. What I want to point out is that there are some exceptions to this rule, but for now we just say that DNA methylation inactivates genes. Besides DNA methylation, histone modifications are also an important epigenetic layer. So what are histones? In a human cell, we normally find 2 meters or 6 feet of DNA. The DNA needs to be very compact in order to fit into such a tiny structure as the cell. And this is where histones come into play. Histones are proteins around which DNA is wrapped. But histones are not only important for fitting DNA into our cells. Similar to us hiding our feelings, histones can hide genes, thereby inactivating them. There are a variety of different histone modifications, and contrary to DNA, histones can be modified at different positions. There are histone methylation, phosphorylation, acetylation, or citrullination, just to name a few, but we will not go deeper into them. It is also less straightforward whether histone modifications activate or inactivate genes. That depends heavily on the context. But there is one important fact I have not told you so far. DNA methylation and histone modifications are reversible. In other words, we can add epigenetic marks or remove existing modifications. In fact, cells do that all the time to control the gene expression, and we can do that in order to develop new therapies against epigenetic diseases. We know many diseases which are caused by mutations in genes. Mutation means that a DNA sequence is directly changed, and that, for example, can make a gene defect. Contrary to genetic diseases, epigenetic diseases are not only caused by mutations in genes, but also by epigenetic changes. A very prominent example of epigenetic diseases are imprinting disorders. Here we find Engelmann syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome, or transient neonatal diabetes mellitus. Imprinting disorders are caused by mutations and epigenetics. A human has two copies of each gene most of the times. One is given by his or her father, the other by his or her mother. While it is quite normal that both copies of each gene are active or inactive, there are several genes where only one copy can be active. We call these genes imprinted genes. In imprinting disorders, the active copy of a gene has been damaged by mutations, while the intact copy is deactivated. This means that if the inactive gene was activated, the patient would not suffer from the respective imprinting disorder. And this is what scientists try to do now, they try to activate the inactive copy in those patients. So we want to change the epigenetics of single genes and single genes only, so how could we do that? And that is, by the way, a question to you. Do you maybe know a technology which could do that? I give you two hints. This technology has been in the media this year quite a lot, and it is known for targeting genes very specifically. We are, of course, talking about this year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry, CRISPR-Cas9 technology. The most basic version of CRISPR-Cas9 allows us to make very specific cuts in the DNA. In principle, it works by importing two different components into a cell. First, we need a molecule called guide RNA, and then we need a Cas9 protein. While the guide RNA helps Cas9 to find the DNA region of interest, the Cas9 protein cuts the DNA. For imprinting diseases, we could use guide RNAs and Cas9 proteins, but we do not want to cut the DNA. Instead, we want to modify the Cas9 protein to not cut, but reactivate genes. In the first step, we change the Cas9 protein so that it is not able to cut DNA anymore. We also often call this version dead Cas9 or dCas9. Then we fuse other parts of proteins to dead Cas9, which can then add or remove epigenetic marks. By using this version of dead Cas9 together with a guide RNA which targets the inactive gene, we can now potentially cure epigenetic diseases. In 2018, a team of researchers used a modified dead Cas9 protein to remove epigenetic modifications in two inactive genes in mice. These two genes are associated with renal fibrosis, and after the therapy, the inactive genes became partially reactivated and the symptoms of the mice became better. There are now a lot of different questions which have to be addressed until we really have these kind of epigenetic disease treatments. These questions concern how we can bring dead Cas9 on guide RNA into the right cells, how we can ensure safety, and so on. So it will probably take a while until these treatments are developed, but I think they're just fascinating. So what about cancer? We already talked a lot about cancer on this channel, especially in this video here. Cancer normally forms through a series of mutations, meaning their DNA is heavily changed. But what cancer cells also often like to do is that they change their epigenetic modifications. To be more precise, they often like to inactivate so-called tumor suppressor genes. Tumor suppressor genes are a very important group of genes which normally kill cells if they tend to become cancer cells. And it's also a reason why they're often inactivated or mutated in cancer cells. So we can now try to develop anti-cancer therapies where we reactivate tumor suppressor genes again. And this idea is actually quite old. There is a number of different drugs which, for example, inhibit DNA methylation. Since cancer cells often use DNA methylation to shut down tumor suppressor genes, we can try to reactivate them by blocking DNA methylation. A famous drug here is 5-azacitidine, which has been shown to be quite effective in AML patients. These kind of drugs are impressive, however they have the main disadvantage that cancer cells tend to become resistant against them. There's also a variety of different drugs which target histone modifications. And a very promising class of drugs right now are histone deacetylase inhibitors, which target a specific histone modification. Similar to DNA methylation, histone deacetylase inhibitors also reactivate tumor suppressor genes. Some of these drugs have already been approved for treating peripheral T-cell lymphomas or drug-resistant multiple myelomas. But right now scientists are evaluating how effective they can be and how they can be made more effective. But for now I want to know, what do you think? What do you think about the idea to turn on or turn off genes to treat diseases? And let me know in the comment section what I should cover next. Also feel free to like this video and subscribe if you're new here and hit the bell button in order to stay informed about the latest discoveries in life sciences. And with that, I'll see ya! If you're interested to know how cancer forms, click on this video. If you're more into ancient viruses trying to mess with our genes, click on this video here.